Well, hello there, and welcome to another online worship opportunity with the community of faith of Alamance Lutheran Church. Hi, I'm Pastor Ron Philibom. Baptism is sometimes called enlightenment. The gospel for this Sunday is the story of the man born blind, healed by Christ. I was blind and now I see, declares the man. And in baptism, God opens our eyes to see the truth of who we are, God's beloved children. As David was anointed king of Israel, in baptism, God anoints our head with oil and calls us to bear witness to the light of Christ in our daily lives. So come along with us today as we learn and we grow together.
Come on, buddy.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen. Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and our failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt, though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen. Well, hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave the only Son he had so that all may receive life. This promise is for you. And God embraces you with divine mercy and forgives you in the name of Christ and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, we come to you today with our biggest questions. Who are we called to be? What do you need from us? Where are you in our midst? How can we follow you more clearly? As we read our word today, we ask that you will weave answers into the text. Speak to us through these ancient stories that we might find what we are seeking in you. With gratitude and open hearts, we pray. Amen. Oh, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Our first reading is from 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I've rejected him from being king over Israel. So fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "But how can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, and they were trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" And he said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. So sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him, for the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shema pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Well, Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "Well, there remains yet the youngest, but he's out keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes, and he was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. We'll read responsively from the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. You restore my soul, O Lord, and guide me along right pathways for your name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, and you anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our second reading comes to us from the fifth chapter of Ephesians and begins with the eighth verse. Once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them, for it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. Our Holy Gospel is from the 9th chapter of John. It begins with the first verse. As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" And Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed, and he came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" And some were saying, "Yes, it is he." And others were saying, "No, but it is just someone who looks like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" And he answered, "The man called Jesus, he made mud, and then he spread it on my eyes and said to me to go to Siloam and wash. Then I went and I washed and I received my sight." They said to him, "Well, where is he?" And he said, "I don't know." They brought him to the Pharisees, this man who had formerly been blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, and then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." And he said, "He is a prophet." And the Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight. And they asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How does he now see?" And his parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind. But we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." And his parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews. For the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age. Ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been born blind. And they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." And he answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner, but one thing I do know, that though I was born blind, now I see." And they said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" And he answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses." See, we know that God has spoken to Moses. But as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. And the man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And they answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and you are trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. And Jesus heard what they had driven him, that they had driven him out. And when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And he answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." And Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. And Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Now some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" And Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say we see, your sin remains." This is the word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Please take a moment to let all the worries of this past week and the concerns that are still circling around your minds today be gone as we quiet ourselves and listen to what the Lord is inspiring us to know. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we come to you this morning grateful just to be here with you in this sacred space. We ask that you inspire us in our Lenten journey through messages like this and in our own devotions at home to share what we learn with others. We look forward to Easter Sunday when we will enthusiastically sing with joy. Until then, bless our ears to hear and our hearts to receive your direction, for you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, we sure have had a week to get used to the time change. And I must say, for some reason, this year it took me a few days just to settle into the new normal. How about you? Did you have any adjustments to losing an hour of sleep? Or are you all caught up and ready to go? This morning we have learned of a man who has spent his life in darkness. Yet after meeting Jesus, his life has changed forever. Fortunately for him, he knew that he would not be plunged into darkness ever again, or have to deal with a time change either. We have several events in Scripture where Jesus heals the blind. For those who attended our first midweek meal and a message for Lent, you might recall in the 10th chapter of Mark, the blind beggar named Bartimaeus heard that Jesus was walking nearby, so he called out and said, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And despite the crowd trying to shut him up, he persisted. Jesus asked that he be brought to him. So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and he came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." And Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." And immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. Now there's no reference that he ever went back and picked up his cloak. He just went and he followed Jesus. Last we noticed that the woman at the well ever came back for her water pot either. See, when you experience Jesus, you lose what you once held on to and follow the truth in a whole new light. People are brought into a whole new understanding through consistent efforts of searching. Nicodemus, for example, who's a wise leader of the Jews, he didn't quite get it at first, but then something clicked and he recognized Jesus as the Son of God. Last week, that woman at the well, she was so perplexed, and yet through her searching, she recognized who Jesus was, and her witness led others to know him too. And today, we learn that how sight was given by believing in who Jesus was. That is why it is so important that you are here. We learn and grow together as we listen to Jesus and seek greater understanding. Our witness helps those who do not know Jesus like you do. For example, did you note in our gospel how the Jews were so mistrusting that the blind man in the story was really blind? Even his parents testified that he was born blind, yet they still refused to accept that he never could see. I wonder what is worse, natural blindness or spiritual blindness? It seems the Jews who were questioning him suffered from something much more difficult, from the inability to see. For even a person without sight can sense things in ways that a person with sight cannot through a heightened ability of their own other senses. But a spiritual blindness is lost in an abyss, and it is up to all of us to reach them, to bring them into the light of Christ. The repeated questions of the man allowed him to change the course of the interrogation and witness to them. Maybe they could not understand because they did not want to understand. Maybe they wanted some logical explanation, certainly not based on faith. When they asked, "How did he open your eyes?" and he answers, "I have told you over and over and you do not listen." What am I not listening to? When the Holy Spirit nudges me, what am I not listening to? Have you ever asked yourself that? Do you resist? See, the religious leaders of the day who declare what they know about Jesus or about anyone who stands for him or with him makes me think of the Christians and the Christian leaders who are known less for the love of Christ and more for how they are trying to prove how right or righteous and pure they are in their rightness and religiousness. That's not us. We follow Jesus with all the wonder and awe of newfound sight. Like Bartimaeus, who doesn't give a second thought to throwing off his cloak and follows Christ's word, or the woman at the well who leaves her water pot behind, and Nicodemus who finally recognizes Jesus as the Son of God. We radically love others who do not look or sound or anything else like us. So as you begin your week, I encourage you to throw some caution to the wind and tell someone about what you have found in this man named Jesus, who has brought you from darkness to light. And now, may the Lord bless and protect you. May the Lord's face radiate with joy because of you, and may he be gracious to you and show you his favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us join together in confessing our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all of creation. Eternal God, you seal us by the Holy Spirit and mark us with the cross of Christ forever in baptism. Inspire us by your love as together we strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We are excited for the inspiration that you will give us as we build events and programs for our families. We ask that you lead the following youth in our congregation: Aaron and Amelia, Angus, Austin, Carly, Clayton, Cora Ann, Creston, Daisy, Daniel, Eleanor, Eli, Ella, Ellie, Emma, Greg, Hunter, James, Jarrett, Jessica, Joan, John, Josie May, Kaya, Katie Rose, Leanne, Layton, Lindsay, Lily, Lizzie, Luke, Marilyn, Max, Megan, Molly, Noah, Owen, Paige, Sam, Sarah Jo, Sophie, Zion, and Tabitha. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Creating God, by your word, you have made all things, and you hate nothing that you have made. Teach us to perceive the beauty of the breadth of your creation, from the grandest mountain range to the smallest springtime bud. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Powerful God, you anoint kings and establish rulers. Guide the work of our elected officials. Encourage them to lead with justice and to remove barriers that impede the well-being of all. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Shepherding God, you lead us beside still waters and restore our souls. Keep watch over those who weep and tend all who are sick and comfort those who grieve, especially Sally and Todd, Melba, Amelia, Carolyn, Betty, Lynn, Katie, Lynn, Peggy, Ednice, Derek, Denise, Mark, Normita, Malachi, Billy, Martha, Blake, Jill, Graham, Mari, Sonia, Beth, Vernon, John, Ray and Gwen, Cheryl, Jareen, Butch, Tommy, Karen, Eric, Steve, Neil and Susan, Annie, Aaron, Bob, Carl and June, Ivan, Jerry, Jeremy and Jonathan, Joan, Cadence, Lynn and Tara, Stanley, Kenneth and Jonathan. Merciful God, receive our prayer. God, our host, you fill us at your table with more than we could ever ask. Feed us with hunger for justice. Equip the feeding ministries of this congregation and community, especially allied churches, City Gate Dream Center, Christmas Cheer, Habitat for Humanity, the Women's Resource Center, and nourish us so we can nourish our neighbors. Merciful God, receive our prayer. You alone are God, and we praise you for walking with those who endure tragedy around the world due to war and natural disaster. Let your presence be known to the people of Ukraine, Haiti, Somalia, and the earthquake victims in Syria and Turkey. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We pray for this congregation, especially those preparing for baptism at the vigil of Easter on Easter Day. Nurture their faith and pour your love into their hearts. Inspire inspire our community by their testimony to God's grace in their lives. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Lord, we trust that we can bring any concern, any anger, anything to you, and that you will listen. Please lift up these prayers and those we now speak out loud or quietly in our own hearts. These are our prayers of needs and hopes, O God, and we trust your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen. God offers Christ to the world. The bread and wine become Christ's own presence. By God's grace, we are recipients and also participants in this gift. But you return to God's mission here and throughout the world through your cash and checks, is what God has first given you through all your own giftedness. We invite you to place your tithes and offerings in the brass plates in the entrances of our sanctuary. You may also visit our website at alamancelutheranchurch.org to participate through digital financial giving. And just click the Give button. We thank you for your generosity, which enables us to follow through with the great commission that Jesus gives us in Matthew 28:19, to go and make disciples to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. Receive the blessing. God, the giver of love, Christ, the resurrection and the life, and the Holy Spirit of rebirth, bless you in this Lenten journey, and may the Lord watch over your going out and your going in, coming in from this time forth forevermore. Amen. Now go in peace, serve others with the love of Jesus. And the congregation responds, "We will," and we ask God to help and guide us. Well, I've enjoyed worshiping with you again this week. I look forward to seeing you again next week. I'm Pastor Ron. Have a blessed and joyous week.